Welcome back. So today, we're going to tackle a classic problem in economics, one that really shows how an entire economy has to make some tough choices when its resources are limited. We're actually going to build a model from the ground up.
Okay, let's just jump right into this with a simple question. Imagine an economy with just 100 workers and 100 machines. Seems straightforward, but figuring out its true potential is this fascinating puzzle that tells us a ton about the real world.
So here's how we're going to break it down. We'll start with the puzzle itself, then look at the resource constraints. After that, we'll build the economic frontier, uncover a pretty surprising hidden cost, and finally, we'll run the numbers on a specific point in our model.
All right, part one. Let's set up the rules of the game for our little economy. You know, every economy has rules for production, and ours is no different. Let's lay out exactly what we're working with.
So here are the production recipes, if you will. To produce 1 ton of milk, this economy needs 2 workers and 4 machines. For 1 ton of cheese, it's a little easier, just 1 worker and 2 machines. These ratios are totally fixed, and they're the foundation of this entire puzzle.
And here are our total resources. The economy has a hard cap, 100 workers and 100 machines. That is it. We can't get more of either one, so every single decision has to be made within these limits.
Now, for the fun part. Before we figure out what we can produce when we combine everything, let's see what the limits would be if we only had one type of resource to worry about. We're going to calculate the absolute maximums for workers and machines completely separately.
Okay, let's start with our labor force. If we put all 100 workers on milk production duty, and just for a second, we completely ignore the machine limit, how much could they possibly make?
Well, the math is pretty straightforward, right? 100 workers divided by the 2 workers it takes to make a ton of milk, that gives us a maximum of 50 tons. Simple as that.
Okay, same logic, but now let's switch gears. What if we task those same 100 workers with making nothing but cheese? What would their max output be then?
They could churn out 100 tons of cheese because it only takes 1 worker per ton. So our labor constraint sets the production limit at either 50 tons of milk or 100 tons of cheese.
But, of course, we can't ignore the machines. If we do the exact same exercise, but this time using our 100 machines as the only constraint, we get a completely different picture. With 100 machines, we can only make 25 tons of milk or 50 tons of cheese. See how these numbers are a lot lower? That's our first big clue. Machines are a tighter bottleneck than labor for both of our products.
So now we've got 2 different boundaries, one from our workers and one from our machines. And this brings us to the most important question of all. What is the actual, real-world boundary for our economy?
The crucial point, the thing to really get, is this. An economy is only as strong as its weakest link. You just can't produce beyond your tightest bottleneck. So the real limit is always the inner boundary, the one that's the most restrictive.
And this real-world boundary has a name. It's called the production possibility frontier, or PPF for short. It basically shows every single combination of goods an economy can produce when it's running at absolute peak efficiency.
So what this means is that the true maximums for our economy are 25 tons of milk because we run out of machines first, and 50 tons of cheese, where again, the machine constraint is the one that holds us back. That is our frontier.
Now, producing on the frontier, that sounds amazing, right? It means we're being perfectly efficient. But does perfect efficiency mean everybody has a job? Let's dig into that.
Let's take a closer look at that point of maximum milk production, 25 tons. We are on the frontier, so we're being as efficient as we possibly can be. But what does that efficiency actually look like when we check in on our workers and machines? Let's break down how we're using our resources here. To make those 25 tons of milk, we need all 100 of our machines. They're all busy, but we only need 50 workers to operate them. That means we have a surplus of 50 workers who are just idle. They're unemployed.
Now, this isn't your typical unemployment. This has a name. It's called structural unemployment. It happens when there's a fundamental mismatch. In our case, we have plenty of willing workers, but we just don't have the other resource, the machines, for them to use.
And this brilliantly illustrates one of the most counterintuitive ideas in economics. You can be running your economy perfectly, wasting nothing, producing right on that frontier, and still have people without jobs simply because of the structure of your production.
Okay, let's put all this into practice. We're going to calculate a specific production mix that is on the frontier but isn't one of those extreme all-or-nothing points.
So here's the scenario. The economy decides to produce 20 tons of milk. The big question is, with the resources that are left over, what's the maximum amount of cheese it can also produce and still stay on that efficient frontier?
Let's just walk through it step by step. First, making 20 tons of milk uses up 40 workers and 80 machines. Okay, so that leaves us with 60 workers and just 20 machines free. Now, what's the bottleneck for making cheese? It's clearly the machines. With only 20 machines left, we can produce a maximum of 10 tons of cheese, and making that cheese only requires 10 workers. So, out of the 60 workers we had left over, 50 are still unemployed.
And that right there, that reveals the core insight of our entire model. We've seen that at every single efficient point on this curve, 50 workers are left without a job. So, if unemployment is literally baked into the system even when it's running perfectly, what does that tell us about the fundamental structure of this economy and the real-world challenges that countries face when trying to balance efficiency with full employment? It's a fundamental trade-off that policymakers grapple with every single day.